Hello, hello everyone. Welcome to your session about getting starting with test-driven development with PHP Unit. This talk is not Type 3 specific, so you can use it in all of your projects. And I was asked whether this talk is a workshop or a talk, whether the session is a workshop or a talk, and I answered yes, because it's a kind of hands-on workshop, but I'm using my hands to program something for you, and you can use your hands to program with me, but there will not be any exercises on top of that for you. So it's okay if you just listen, but you can also do the exercises, do the work with me. A few words about me. I'm Olli Klee at Twitter and Oliver Klee at GitHub and at my domain. And part of my time I teach. I teach unit testing, extension development, and general how to build better software or how to better build software, two different things, and how to say no. How to say no to software without tests or how to say no to demands on your time and stuff like that. I develop extensions. I do some Ruby and Rails work on top of that. And I'm working on singing karaoke. I'm working towards power metal, but I'm not there yet. Okay, so during this session, I have three goals I'd like to achieve. The first one is I'd like to get you a general understanding what is test-driven development in the first place and why would I want to do it? And do I want to do it at all? I hope yes, but I hope that you'll be test infected after this session. Being test infected means that you have a bad feeling when you write code without tests. It's like changing the light bulb without having checked that the power is off for that light. Or it's like working on the motor of your car without making sure that it's really off. So you maybe you could lose your hand in that. Or being test infected is delaying the going to lunch because you haven't written the test for the piece of code you've written yet. That is being test infected. And I hope I'll infect you with enthusiasm for tests during the session. And also, I hope we all, including me, will have lots of fun during the session. Are these three goals okay for you? Great, that's good. We can work with that. Okay, there are some rules during this session, during this workshop. The first one is the there are no stupid questions rule. There are explanations from me that do not fit what you need at the moment, and there are questions that are just there in the room for taking and that someone needs to pose. So if there are any questions, just ask. If it's really urgent, you can interrupt me in the middle of the sentence, but it's also okay if you wait until I finish my sentence. Just raise your hand, or if your mouth is faster than your hand, then you can shout in the room and I'll try my best to answer the questions. The more questions, the better. And if the question is way off, then I'll tell you in the most friendly terms possible. So don't be afraid to ask questions. The second rule is the Joker rule. The Joker rule says that if there is anything that stops you from learning, like it's too fast, or I don't understand the term, or could you please repeat that, or I think we need to have a short break so people can set up their environment for 5 more minutes or something like that, you don't have the right, but you have the obligation to raise your hands and say, Joker, we need to solve this problem, there's something that blocks my learning here. And you have an unlimited number of jokers, so you don't need to ration your jokers in some way. Are these two rules okay for you? The no stupid questions rule and the joker rule. Okay, great. Then the session will work this way. First, I introduce you to some terms and concepts on the slides, and then I do some coding. During the coding, I'll do it here, and you can code with me, or you can just watch. Both ways, you'll learn something, and both ways, I hope it will be quite entertaining. Okay, so who of you has attended Daniel's session on Daniel's session introduction to PHP Unit? I have. Okay, that's about a third. Who of you has used PHP Unit before today? Who of you has accidentally broken some code because it was not well tested? That's very good. Who of you knows the difference between unit tests and functional tests in the Type 3 world? Okay. Who of you knows what the workflow of test-driven development is? Okay. So some of you are kind of a repeating offenders of being test-driven, working in a test-driven way. That's great. Okay, so let's see what unit tests and automated tests are in the first place. When you manually test an application, you click somewhere and enter some data somewhere and then compare the result with something and you enter some other data. And second after second, your brain dries out and you die in your mind. And that is not good. And manual testing is very slow. And so as we like to be very efficient in our work, we kind of skip over the manual testing because it's so much work and then things break and everyone's unhappy and we want to avoid that. So we're automating that. We want to click on a button and the computer then enters some data here and checks the result and clicks on a button. All that is very fast, which means that you're encouraged to run the tests much more often and this will result in a lot less breakage in your application. So it's about saving work in the long run. You just heard me say in the long run. So one thing to take away is automated tests are a very good thing for long-running projects, but for throwaway projects that will last a week or a month, automated testing might not pay out. For long-running projects, it is a very bad idea to not have automated tests because then you are afraid of making changes, and that is bad. Okay, then the most obvious reason for testing is you want your code to do something, and you want your test to check that the code does what you expect it to do. That's the most obvious thing. Another thing is, when you change something here, you want to be sure that over there, nothing breaks. Who of you has changed something here and later found out that something was broken over there, which you did not know about? Oh, great. You've all had the pain. And now think something about people. It's bad enough that you break something when you change something, but you also want to avoid other people breaking what you have done, because that's very bad for the interpersonal climate in your team. If you come into the company in the morning and see that something has broken with their ass, what you've built up with your hands or with your brain, that's very bad and you would like to avoid that. You would like the people to notice that they've broken something before they check it into master or whatever your current Git workflow main branch is at the time. And as projects get more complex, it becomes humanly impossible to know how all things are interconnected. So it's impossible to know what will change or what might break if I change something here. You need to have automated tests in place to make sure that nothing breaks when you change something here, or there, or there, or there. Who of you knows the official, not trademarked definition of refactoring? I do. Okay, another one does. I'm not alone it. Okay, the definition of refactoring is not just clean up the code, but the definition is improve, or hopefully improve, the structure of code without changing to improve the structure of the code while keeping the outward behavior the same. So the software should work the same, but should be better still in the inner workings. And there is a kind of chicken egg problem. You have a very big and very complex application, and you'd like to clean it up. But if you clean it up, you might break something. So you don't clean it up, but you just add a little tiny ugly patch on top of that and a little bit of functionality. And the application that has started small and beautiful in the beginning has become a huge unmaintainable monster. And if all is covered with tests, you can run the tests and see that everything works, and you change something, you clean something up, and then you run the tests again. And either the tests are green meaning everything is still okay, or they are red, and you've seen that you've broken something, you can fix it. If you have a big application without tests, there's the chicken-egg problem, because you cannot run the test to see that everything is okay, and adding tests is hard because you don't understand the application and you have to start somewhere, but that is solvable. It's ugly and painful, but solvable. So if you start with tests in the beginning, refactoring is possible in the first place, or it's possible without breaking things, and you don't want things to break. Who of you has had the pain of working with such an old, big, unmaintainable monster in the past? Okay, actually I had a customer project where the customer called me in to help with such a project where it was impossible to fix any bugs, to add any features, because it was so big and so prone to breakage that every time they poked the application, it broke. And there it was my job to improve the structure and in the first place add tests. One other important or very helpful benefit of automated tests is if you want to do a type of 3 update or upgrade, so you run the tests, possibly some front-end tests and see that everything is okay, then you upgrade your extension or your complete type of 3 installation, and then you run the tests again. And if the tests are green, you know that the update has not broken anything. Or you're pretty sure, you can never be completely sure, but you're pretty sure. And if something is broken, you see it before the customer complains that the installation is hawked. A kind of hidden benefit of automated tests is that it will improve the structure of your code. The reason is that if code is not well structured, it is very hard to test. Or the other way around, if code is hard to test, this is often because it's not well structured. So if you start with tests in the first place, this kind of forces you to keep your code well structured in smaller units, smaller classes, and well-defined interfaces between the classes. Because you want to avoid the pain of having not so easily testable code. Yes. No. Automated tests is the code. It's the test code. And test-driven development is a workflow that will that defines in which order you write what kind of code, so production code and test code, and when you run the tests. So the tests are a result, the automated tests are a result of test-driven development, but you can have automated tests before without test-driven development. So artifacts in process. Any more questions at the time? Okay. And then we all like to be happy, and testing makes you happy. There's the green bar, the progress bar, and green means everything is okay. And there are, depending on the UI you use for testing, there are two kinds of broken. There's yellow broken and red broken. Usually yellow means some test has failed. So 1 and 1 is not 2, but suddenly 4, because mathematics in the universe is broken. And red means there was a PHP error or an exception has been thrown or something like that. The thing to take away here is green is good and not green is not good. Very simple. And the exception for this is the yogurt in your fridge. If it's green, that's not good. Don't eat it. Then your question was right on time. The workflow about test-driven development, or as some people call it, test first, works like this. Hooray, you have a green bar. Green bar being defined as the tests are, there's at least one test and it is successful and runs. Then you think about some new feature or bug fix or some other change and write a test for this. So it's kind of a reverse psychology, but reverse coding. So you're right, it tests that checks that the new behavior is there and that it works. And as you might have guessed, the test should fail because you have written the test for the code, but the code is not there yet. If the test does not fail here, if this is green, what could be the reason for this? Yes. Yeah, the test is bad, or another reason, yes? Yeah. So either the test is broken, or the code is already there and you just didn't know it, or you wanted to make sure that it works correctly, which is great, which saves us work. So unit testing saves you work in some cases, and of course in the long run, but in some cases a bit more work to improve the world in general and your code. Okay, so the test is yellow or red, it does not pass, then you write some code and hopefully the tests are green after that. If the tests are not green, you need to modify your code so the tests are green. Or you might need to modify your test because your tests are still not the way, do not test what actually you want to test. And then rinse and repeat. This cycle is quite small in your daily work. So you want to work in write a small test, write a little bit of code, and then get to green very fast. This is called not the hack and pray pattern. Hack and pray is an anti-pattern, which means that you write some code and you hope that it works, or that if it doesn't work, that nobody will notice. I strongly recommend it against using this pattern. The green bar pattern means you start with a green state of your application, of your test framework, and you want to get to green very fast again. Very fast meaning like 1 minute or 5 minutes or maybe tops an hour, but not something like a day or a week. You want to have quick feedback and have working code as fast as possible. And at any time, from starting from the state of green, you can refactor and hopefully stay green. Or if you break something during the refactoring, you know that you have broken the working code and you need to get it working again. Any questions so far? Okay, that's for me and the slides doing something together. Now I will code. I'm switching to the wrong keyboard shortcut. Okay, I'm switching to PHP Storm. I'd like to have some coffee. More specifically, I'd like to code a coffee beverage model. This is not rocket science, this is coffee science. And I've thought about what my coffee beverage model should do. It should be there in the first place. And it should have a title. The title, if I have not set a title, the title should be an empty string. And if I set a title like cappuccino or espresso or double macchiato latte with hazelnut and half an hour later coffee, so if I set that, I will get that back. And my coffee beverage should have a size, meaning the number of milliliters in the container. It should be zero by default, which is very bad for waking up with a kind of coffee. And of course, I can set the size and get the size and back again. I hope that no one of you has been in Andreas' talk about the missing parts of domain-driven design, why setters and getters are bad. And if I set a size smaller than zero, an integer smaller than zero, there should be an exception, because otherwise the time-space continuum would be broken and that would be bad for every one of us. And if we have time, we can add flavors to our coffee. I like coffee with flavor, not just black water with caffeine, but actually with flavor. We have a flavor model for that with some kind of title like hazelnut or cinnamon or lemon for those who have the coffee a bit strange. And I can have no flavors for my coffee, or one flavor or several flavors added. So This pattern here is called test list. The test list is the official term for think first, code second. The longer explanation of test list is, if you want to code, you really need to put something on paper or on code that is a very quick list of the behavior you'd like to achieve. Because otherwise, it's very easy to get lost during coding the test and losing your path where you want to go there and get distracted. It really improves your efficiency and your focus when you first write the behavior and then work through that list. It also is connected to the way your brain works and to how every brain works. And because there are two modes of working, there's the planning mode and the working stuff away mode. And there's a cost connected to switching between the modes, and it's much more efficient if you first plan and then stay in the working mode afterwards. Okay, so let's do some coding. I quickly show you how this whole thing is set up. This is a composer-based project. The important thing here is the dependency on PHP unit. The other things are the normal stuff like auto load and some things to configure how the sources are fetched and a name, and that is not important for this. We're just stretching, or we're asking a question? Okay, great. Sorry, when do I require PHP init, and when do I require what? I require PHP unit slash PHP unit when I'm not working within the type of 3 context, and when I'm doing extension tests, I require the NeMo testing framework. Actually, there are two testing frameworks for type of 3. There is the NeMo testing framework by Nicole and Helmut, Nicole Cordes and Helmut Tummel, and then there's the core testing framework. The main difference when to use which is if you're doing extension development and your extension should work across multiple long-term support type of 3 versions, you should use the NeMo testing framework because it contains an abstraction for the different things in different type of 3 versions. If you're doing core development, you should use the core testing framework. And if you're developing extensions for only one major version of type of 3, you can choose either one. Okay, and as I'm not working with type of 3 here, but just plain PHP and PHP unit, I'm using the PHP unit package here. Any more questions? Then about the structure of the directory structure. The technical requirement by default is that there is a tests folder, and the human convention is that it's uppercase first, so tests. Then if you have different kinds of tests, unit tests and other kind of integration or functional or any other kind, you have subfolders here. And in that, you have the test classes. They are required to end with uppercase test. Or if you have a time machine to go back 10 years, you could also use underscore and then lowercase test case. But today, nobody does it anymore because we love camel case, and it's also shorter. Okay, let's have a look at the test. We are going to test the world, because if the world is broken, what can we do? In addition to that, we can do nothing. So we need the world to work correctly. The test case extends the test case base class, which comes from the PHP unit framework. about the thing about what is a test and what is a test case, they are the same depending on what you mean at what point. Okay, so they're basically the same, and because of the way things were built in the past and how people decided about what the base class is called test case, and the test itself is only called something test and not something test case, and that's inconsistent, and I'm sorry about that, and we need to live with that. I'm sorry. Okay, so we want to test that the universe works before we do any coffee testing. Create a public function. Universe works. I like pidgin English. Works. In the tests, we have so-called assertions. Assertions are a statement about how a statement about the state of the universe of the, at this point of time. They are methods. They are static, so I'd like to call them statically. Although there are some people in the universe, including most of the core coders, who call them not statically. And I say assert same. So I'd like to say something is the same as something. There's also assert equals. The differences between between assert same and assert equals is the difference between two equals signs and three equals signs. Who knows what the difference between two and three equals signs is in PHP? I do. Okay. And I hopefully I hope that the others do know as well, but just have something with their hand. Okay. I'd like to assert that 2 plus 2 is 4. But yeah, that's the that's a keyword. Thanks. Okay. The convention for assert same is that the first argument is the expected value and the second argument is the actual value. So I'm testing that 2 plus 2 is actually 4. And now I run the test, one world test with PHP unit. And there's a warning. Why is there a warning? Okay, that was not... Oh, okay. I had not planned this, but there's an excellent opportunity to show something else, which you need to have the test actually work as a test. PHP unit cannot look into your brain, so you need some kind of annotation. You need an annotation to tell PHP unit this method actually is a test. Use the @test annotation, and I'm also return type here. So let's run again. Oh, it's green. We have one test, the universe works. Phew, okay, that's good to know. We can continue from this. Any questions so far? Okay, then let's work with some coffee. This is the world test. I am the right, yeah. Okay. More about the directory structure. We are kind of following the XBase pattern of how classes are named and how the namespace structure is. So we have a classes domain model, and we have the coffee beverage model, which models the coffee beverage. And within tests unit, we have domain model coffee beverage test. So the directory structure is the same. And for the coffee beverage class, we have the coffee beverage test class. This is in no way required as far as PHP unit is concerned. It's not technically required, but it's by convention to make it easier for humans to recognize which class is tested and to find the test for the class. Okay. Let's look into coffee beverage test. Okay, this is big enough, I think. We have some more things here in the coffee beverage test. First, we have a function set up. The purpose of the setup function is to build things before the actual test is run. And if you have several tests in one class, you can save work by putting things in setup that are always the same for all tests or that might be needed in most of the tests. Then we have the subject field here. You can name it any way you want, but the convention is that it's the subject of the test, so the thing to test, or an instance of the class to test. Who of you have seen this named fixture instead in some core code? Okay, that's wrong, and that's my fault. actually, it was me who wrote the first unit test for the Type 3 core, and I had misunderstood something when I learned unit testing. I thought that this was called fixture, and so I named it fixture, and it stayed there in the place and multiplied, and people took it as an example, although it was not the recommended convention at the time. So if it's called fixture, actually, it should be called subject, and real fixtures are a different kind of thing. So what we are doing here is we build an instance of the coffee beverage class, and we check that we can actually build it. Usually, we do not have this test, but this is something to get started in the first place. I'm testing that my subject is an instance of the coffee beverage class. Let's run this coffee beverage test. Oh, okay. I need to scroll out a bit. It's green because I've already written the test, the coffee beverage class. Let's move fast. No, let's move at all and break things. Also, I like breaking things. Oh no, it's broken. Okay, then I can code really fast by undoing things. Okay, it's green again. Then we can work on the test list. You can see here that the things I'm testing are quite small. This pattern is called one thing at a time. Of course, you want to have a quick feedback cycle between things being green, writing a test, and the test being not green, and getting it to green again. Let's work on the coffee beverage test. Let's drop this test. And oh, actually, we have the test that the class is there. I'm going to remove that because actually, if the class were not there, the setup method would fail already. So PHP unit would not reach this test. Okay, so the focus is not where I'd like it to be. Yes, I've just put it in setup to save some work, but it would work fine as well. Okay, I'm using a live template here to avoid having to write public function blah and the parentheses and then the attest annotation. So a live template that builds this for me. Okay, so title by default is empty. When I'm doing the baby steps, I'm also using names that describe what the point of the test is. This has two purposes. The first purpose is that a reader does not need to read the actual test code to know what the test is about in general. And the other thing is that a reader can check that the test actually does the right thing. So they can compare whether the test name matches what the test code does. Let's do that. Assert same. I am expecting an empty string, this subject get title. Okay, before I run that, any guesses what will happen now? Why? Oh, yeah, right. Let's do that. Yeah, I've broken something, great. Okay, yeah. this is... it has changed over time how good PHP unit is at catching errors. So let's build this. By the way, usually I generate the getters and setters, so I'm building them here by hand just for teaching purposes. Public function get title, it returns a title, a string. What? Okay. Yay, I'm the greatest coder in the world. I've written a better. And the pattern which I'm using here is fake it till you make it. So as far as the requirements so far are concerned, this is the perfect code because it does all it needs to do. But now we are going to add the setter and getter. We're going to add the setter. So I'm testing that set title actually sets the title. It's kind of a redundant, but it's still more expressive than set title works correctly, because then the reader does not know what correctly actually means. Set title sets title. What's your favorite coffee beverage? None. Okay, great. None. Okay, valid point. The subject set title. It's the first time someone replied that, but that's fine as well. Okay, I'm expecting the title and the title. Okay, and this, of course, will break again because there is no set title method. Okay, I'm running the test first before implementing the code, because I've learned from the talk today that you first run the test before to see that it's red or yellow before writing the code. Okay, as expected, it's yellow in this case, so I'm writing the setter, set title, string title. I cannot type words when I'm here. I cannot write code. This title, and I'm adding the property, and this will title. No. Okay, let's run the tests, and hopefully they should be green. Okay, so I've broken something, and as I had a test in place, I could see that I had broken something. That is great. Hooray! I have another test in place. Okay, and using the magic of the live templates, I'm doing the same with size. So size by default is 0, and if I set a size, it gets returned by getSize. It's basically the same, but just with an integer instead of a string. Just int. And that was the wrong thing. Yeah. Nice. This is very handy when I'm developing tests. Okay, so get size initially returns 0. I'm testing that 0 is what get size returns, and set size some number, and it gets returned, and it will break as expected. And I'm doing what I normally do when I'm adding setters and getters and fields. I'm auto generating the stuff, as I cannot type, as you can see. I don't know why it happens that way, but it's always when I give presentations. Code generate getters and setters for size. And there it is. It has annotations, which I don't need, but which I don't care about. And hooray, I've written it. Okay, so we've done this. And okay. So, as I've said before, we'd like to avoid the universe imploding, the time-space continuum imploding, if we have a negative size. Thank you for the beverage. That's called check the error handling. What we've tested so far is the so-called happy path, when everything is right, when everything works correctly. but usually you'd want to check that the errors are handled in a clearly defined way. For example, if you are writing the software for a nuclear power plant, you'd want to make sure that if something is broken, it's still handled in a clearly defined and okay-ish way. Or if you're writing the checkout process of an online shop, you'd also want to make sure that if someone buys the only bag of coffee beans that was left, and someone else had it in their shopping cart at the time, still they both would not buy the bag of coffee beans at the same time, but something, some error message would be shown. Hey, your bag of coffee beans is gone. Please select some tea bags or something like that. Okay, so let's check the error handling. Just set size with negative value throws exception. I'm buying an N. Expect exception, I'm expecting an invalid argument exception. And I'm using the biggest or smallest, depending on the way you look at it, a negative number minus one. Because it's the method is not static. And so it's same on the other end is static. And I have no idea why it's not static, because actually it works like an assertion. I have no idea. But I'll be at the code sprint with Sebastian Bergmann, the author of PHP Unit, in September, and maybe I can ask him there. And I'd also like to make sure that a size of zero is okay. So empty coffee barrels are kind of a bad thing, but they will not make the time-space continuum implode. Set size, I cannot type. With zero is okay. There is some annotation about no assertions, but I don't remember it. Set size zero. Okay, so I'm going to run this now. Okay, and it's broken. Why? Because what? Oh, okay, this test did not perform any assertions. Okay. If size smaller than zero, valid argument exception. Zero and exception code. And here the thing is about not performing any assertions. Does anyone remember what the annotation is? 1 minute. I don't either, so what is the annotation for this? The thing I'm testing for is that there is no exception thrown, but there is no assertion for, and no exception is thrown, and the test would break if an exception was thrown. Okay, let's do that. We have, in the few seconds we have left, we can do this. We're working against the clock here. Get signed. Hooray. Okay. So, I hope that you had some fun. I hope that you have become kind of test infected. And I also hope that you have gotten a bird's eye understanding of what test-driven development is and how to start with it. Thank you.